I know that most of you are pretty busy in the evenings because you have at least one other pursuit to occupy you in the evenings at present. But how many of you are aware of the television program Mad Men? Yeah, see, these are the ones that have obviously graduated. Mad Men, of course, is set in Madison Avenue, the home of, or the spiritual home at least, of the advertising profession, if in fact we can call it a profession. But this morning we have a particular treat in store for us. We have from Madison Avenue, perhaps not one of the original Mad Men, but certainly a genuine Mad Men, if one can put it that way. I won't spend any time talking about Peter Cullinane's background in the advertising industry because I've been fortunate enough to have a sneak preview of his speech, and I know that he's going to touch some historical markers in his career and in the growth of the advertising industry as he goes along. Suffice to say that at present, Peter is a co-founder and director of Assignment. He'll talk more about that. It is a very unusual, I'd actually hesitate, Peter, to call it an agency. We'll leave because of the way in which it operates. And for those of you who frequent the Auckland restaurant scene, you undoubtedly have seen glass bottles of Antipodes water on the table. Peter is similarly a founder of Antipodes water. So, welcome, Peter. Good to see you. I'm sorry we didn't have your branded water this morning.
Nonetheless, bring a bottle. It's good to see you. Thank you. Thank you, Peter. Good morning. Look, I have no idea how long the speech is going to take. It was finished only minutes ago. It's fresh off the press. But I think it will be about half an hour. But I think it will actually be a good half hour. It won't necessarily be a good half hour, but it will take, you know, at least half an hour. I'm going to use a combination of you know, high-tech stuff, slides behind me, PowerPoint, and my speech notes. So sort of bear with me as we go along. I hope all this is going to hold together. This is always sort of a very nervous occasion, you know, the beginning of giving a presentation. And breakfast meetings remind me of a time many years ago when, for whatever reason, I was invited to sit at the top table of a post-budget breakfast meeting in Wellington. And in those days, I haven't been to a post-budget breakfast for a while, but in those days they were attended by sort of hundreds of people doing just what we're doing this morning, sort of eating away and then waiting to have a quick analysis of the budget. So I was at the, for whatever reason, I was at the top table, and there were six of us sitting in a straight line like this facing, you know, hundreds of people out there having breakfast. And sitting in the middle of the table of six was the then Prime Minister Jim Bolger, who had just really led the National Party back into power. And sitting to his immediate right was the new American ambassador, Della Newman. And then there was me, and I was sort of at the end of the table. And then on the other side, I don't know, there was Barry Coleman and one or two others. But that's sort of that was the setup. And Jim Bolger and the National Government were very keen to repair the very strained relations, if you remember, that had existed under Labour with the whole anti-nuclear thing. And Jim was in earnest conversation with Ms. Newman, and I was sitting there feeling sort of increasingly isolated and disconnected from that conversation. And I was trying desperately to think of something really intelligent to say, you know, because you're sitting there and everyone's just sort of watching you as you sit there eating your breakfast, which is disconcerting. And clearly I wasn't part of that conversation. And that was at the time of Desert Storm, for those of you, you know, who remember Desert Storm, which was so ably led by General Schwarzkopf, hence the photograph this morning. And I had followed his every move, and I remember sitting on a beach in Taupo, on Lake Taupo, on a really remote little beach, and that was just when those tiny little televisions had come out, and I remember watching that, you know, that classic thing of the Scud missile sort of scooting around, and I was sitting on the sand on a beach in the middle of Taupo watching the war live. It was a curious time. And so I followed every move of General Schwarzkopf, and that suddenly gave me an opportunity. I thought, right. So I tapped Ms. Newman on the shoulder, and she was right in the middle of a conversation, and she turned around really reluctantly to me, and I thought, not a good opening. And she said, what? I said, oh, well, look, Madam Ambassador, I just want to say how incredibly impressed we are in New Zealand with the way General Schwarzenegger is handling Desert Storm. And she looked at me and she said, Schwarzkopf. And that's the only word of conversation that I had that morning. And so the rest of the breakfast was spent, you know, doing what I was doing before, sitting red as a beetroot, watching everyone else eat. So that may have put me off sort of breakfast speeches for some time. The topic of this morning is doing business in an increasingly competitive and complex global environment. And so I thought what I'd do this morning, start off by telling you actually what I do. And in telling you what I do, I can hopefully give some perspectives, some insights into doing business in that increasingly competitive world. And it occurs to me, by the way, that the present is always and has always been regarded as more complex than anything that's preceded it, if only because we lack the ability to look at the present with hindsight. So, you know, I think, you know, people thought they lived in an incredibly complicated world, you know, 1,000 years ago, and they will in another 1,000 years. It's just that we're living in the middle of it, so it always seems more competitive and complex. It's so competitive and complex that we can't really conceive how it could be more so. Unless, as everyone in this room has done, you choose to make it more so by doing something as intensive, say, as an MBA, which is how I sort of got dragged into this. My whole career has been in the ideas business, and one definition of an idea, which I just took on a screen grab, is a feeling that something is probable or possible. And it seems to me that ideas can be born from facts or intuited before the facts are known. In my mind, facts are there for the gathering. They exist. They can be collected, collated, and analysed. Doing so is a complex task, unquestionably, and done well, they can clearly be used as the basis upon which sound decisions can be made. Just how complex the task was driven home to me only a few days ago when Daniel Vidal gave us our first taste of the consultancy process, as espoused by the management consultancy business, or should I say industry. I think we talked about industries and management consulting. Facts are very comforting. They speak of logic, but of course what's logical is not necessarily what's right, and what's right isn't necessarily logical. Of course, if you've got your facts right, then you can't be accused of being wrong. But it's never the entire answer. To me, ideas and facts are rather like the chicken and egg. But the real skill is not really in either camp. It's not so much in analysing the facts or creating ideas. The real skill in doing business in an increasingly competitive world comes from the ability to apply good judgment. It's judgment that ultimately is the most valuable commodity, the judgment to decide what facts are important and what ideas have value. We've built our business on offering superior judgment, and I'll talk about that a little later. In our experience, good judgment comes from two places. From the outside, from the very sort of edge of things, and then from the very middle of things. From a sort of a naive intelligence viewpoint, or from informed reasoning. Both routes offer terrific opportunity. To my mind, it's as wrong to assume that only facts deliver the right answers, as it's wrong to believe that it's all about just ideas. The thing about ideas chosen with good judgment is that you can get to the right answers sometimes in a fraction of the time it takes to methodically work through an exhaustive analysis of the facts. In an increasingly competitive world, speed is a crucial weapon. And that's sort of where leadership, I think, is tested. Leadership is directly associated with decisiveness, an ability to sense what's right in a situation where others, faced with exactly the same information, are paralyzed into activity, or what's sometimes referred to as paralysis by analysis. No matter how the facts and ideas present themselves, The most valuable commodity any leader can possess is the judgment to choose the right answer and the right course of action. Both take good judgment, and that's what clients above all else value, because good judgment is such a rare commodity, whether it's in New Zealand or China or the US or anywhere else for that matter. Now, I would say that, of course, because that's basically what my business is all about. My business is really the sum of my experience. But I really do think I'm right, because I think that good ideas are a damn sight harder to find than good facts. So now I'm going to take you through a little journey and hopefully draw some lessons as we go. Talking of experience, I should tell you about mine. I started my career in advertising for Ogilvy and Mather, which back in those heady days was sort of known as the University of Advertising. I fell into advertising by complete chance. It's a sort of long, involved story. But there wasn't, you know, an iota of analysis involved in that particular decision. It was unquestionably the sort of the luckiest break that I've ever had. It was a time when marketing's emergence as a serious lever of business. And for me, it was a case of being in the right place at the right time. I went from being a sort of a cruiser to a bruiser. I worked every hour God gave me and learnt from the feet of the best in the business. I had found my niche and I loved every single moment of it. From there I joined Mackay King, a small New Zealand-owned agency. We grew from obscurity to the number two market position in a short few years. It was an extraordinary time for us. The agency in those days was led by Terry King, another ex-Ogilvy and Mather staffer. Terry had the wonderful knack of being able to feel like a winner and the ability to win just enough to reinforce the feeling. It's a really interesting thing. You know, it is sort of self-fulfilling. It's a terrific skill, that. The ability to create a winning environment, because it lifts the game of everyone from the most senior to the most junior. If you feel like a winner and you act like a winner, then chances are you will be a winner. You know, it is such an attitudinal thing. Skill and attitude is a really potent mix. And the combination of those two things is really important. My brother often quotes this, you know, after hubris, nemesis. He quotes it to me quite a lot, actually. No doubt he's right, but without self and team belief, you'll get nowhere. You know, if you don't really believe that you can hack it, chances are you won't. During that time, I went from account manager to joint chief executive, and then led Mackay King, as it was then, through a merger with Saatchi & Saatchi, to become the biggest and best agency in the country. I was in my early 30s, and it was an extraordinary learning curve. We were the biggest agency in New Zealand, and Saatchi & Saatchi at that time was the biggest advertising agency worldwide. Saatchi's had a saying in those years, which was, it's good to be big, it's better to be good, and it's best to be both. And it's sort of really easy to say, and it's really, really hard to pull off. You know, it's really hard to be really big and really good. Usually, you know, size and goodness don't necessarily go hand in hand. Right through the 90s, we held that position in New Zealand. They were dazzling years, really. Wonderful people. And I worked with absolutely brilliant people, fabulous clients, and great work. We also got outstanding results. Our New Zealand operation was consistently rated by the Industry Bible, which is the Advertising Age publication in the US, as one of the top 10 agencies worldwide. So that's our little agency in New Zealand. Year in, year out, we were one of the top 10. So they were sort of brilliant learning years. And the thing about advertising is that you always have a commercial break. So what I'm going to do now is I'm going to take a little break, and I'm just going to play just two spots from that sort of era when I was at Saatchi's. Both of them, you'll remember, one was a commercial for a client of ours, Toyota, and the other was a commercial for ourselves, for Saatchi & Saatchi. And the funny thing about advertising is advertising agencies normally never advertise themselves. And in fact, I don't really think they deeply believe in it themselves. It's a great test. It's really surprising. So I'm just going to play you two spots now, and then we'll move on.
Back.
remember that, but that, I think, was one of the few commercials that's ever been used as a sermon. It went to air, and within the first week we had a number of calls, one from a church in Auckland who thought it made a better sermon than the vicar could possibly deliver. they were brilliant. They were brilliant years, and what made them absolutely brilliant for me was the team that I worked with. Around me at that time, the team included Kim Thorpe, who you may have heard of, but he would be rated worldwide as one of the industry's great talents. He's probably the best creative director this country's ever produced. Howard Grieve, certainly one of the most intuitive people I've ever worked with, and James Hall, who replaced me as CEO in New Zealand and then went on to become chairman of Saatchi's in the UK. In the latter part of the 90s, I became worldwide executive board member responsible for Australasia and then moved to New York, where I was chief operating officer worldwide. And my arrival in the US was marked by my first brush with academia in many years when I went to the Harvard Business School and did the advanced management program. And that was sort of the beginning of an incredibly frantic time for me. My time in the States was frantic, and in my last 12 months there, that was in 2001, I was actually away from home more than three quarters of the year. I lived a life doing business absolutely in a complex and competitive global environment. I had a frantic schedule. I'd be in Europe one week and in Asia the next, and in some weeks I'd be in both of those parts of the world all at the same time. And it was about then that I realised, I think, a couple of really, to me, really interesting things about doing business in such a competitive world. One is that every country believes they're different, you know, and there wouldn't be, I always call it the Polish solution, because you'd fly into a country to talk about whatever the issues were in that country, and the first thing you would hear is, what you've got to understand about Poland is it's really different here. And so you go through all of that, and you filter it all away, and you think, well, actually, to some degree, of course it's different. But people are the same everywhere, and to an equal degree, as much as every country is different, then every country is the same as well. From a global management perspective, it's infinitely more efficient to look for similarities than the differences. You know, it's just the way it is. The simple fact is that management only has so many minutes in a day, and this is my sort of minutage insight, actually. First of all, what happens is you allocate time in proportion to the value of the country, not the size of the problem. And so I don't know if you've been caught up in the world of multinationals, but sometimes if you're in New Zealand or Australia or whatever, you can have an incredibly complex issue on your plate, but it only gets 5 minutes worth of senior management time. Well, why? Because that's as much as you can afford to give before you move on to a smaller issue, but its impact is much greater when you look at some issue in the US or whatever. So it's something to be really aware of. This sort of minutage thing is really important. The second thing that happens is that you absolutely simplify everything so you don't have to start from scratch. You know, it's a bit like giving a speech, and the lesson I've never learned is to have one speech and alter it. So every time, here we go, I start again. And weeks later, out comes the speech. But it's really important that the way to run things on a global scale is to really look for similarities and to, wherever possible, replicate decisions that you've taken in the past. During this sort of that period of time, we had a phrase which was a very sort of Kevin Roberts phrase, and a bloody good one actually, which is a sort of one team, one dream. It's corny, but it's really useful nonetheless. And the sort of sense of one team, one dream was, we're just not interested in what the differences are. You know, we're all in this boat together, so let's get on with it. It's a really interesting way of handling it. But that really does, I think, explain why multinationals often appear a little clumsy or heavy-handed. They don't have the luxury of nimbleness. That can be an absolute advantage for countries like New Zealand and businesses like ours. Because when you are small and nimble, then you can zig when others zag. And I know that we were not the first to coin that phrase, but it was an original phrase when we coined it. And it's a really good one, by the way. You know, as soon as everyone's heading in that direction, time to head in a different direction. And that's what you can do when you are small and nimble. And it's absolutely what you can't do when you're big and clumsy. So for over a decade, I was part of an executive committee. And in the last few years, that executive committee bore an uncanny likeness to the case history that we've just been working on, which is Rudy Gassner and the BMI executive team. With Kevin Roberts playing the role of Rudy. And I hate to say that I loved my time on that team, and I was challenged and rewarded, and I was able to work with Kevin, who I absolutely rate as a transformational leader. So it was a terrific time. So maybe here's a good place to reflect on what I believe leadership is all about. Oh, no, I won't. I'll just go back one. So it's looking the wrong way. Have you been looking at this all the time while I've been talking? Oh, righto. Well, look, sorry about that. Let me just rocket through this. This was an answer to a question that we were asked only on Saturday. How do we find leadership? So I just thought I'd give you my definition because I have the luxury of being able to do it. The first thing is that I believe leadership is the demonstration of successful judgment. I reckon it's all about judgment, by the way. It's absolutely about judgment. Apply to situations which involve and affect others. There's not a whole lot of point in leading yourself anywhere, you know, but so it has to involve others and it has to affect others. Leadership isn't passive, it's active and it's demonstrable. Leadership is all about success, not necessarily every time, but sufficient to engender belief in others. You know, you can't be an effective leader for long if you don't engender a belief in your ability in those who you seek to lead. So there can be no leadership without followership. Leadership is good judgment in action. Judgment can be learnt. I absolutely believe that. It can be intuitive and it can be both. But without good judgment, no leader is able to maintain a successful leadership role. Leadership is not an abstract notion. It only works sort of in the doing. How judgments are applied is just as important as the judgment itself. Now, I really think that's really important. It's, you know, leadership is all about the doing of it. Leadership can be personal or collective attribute, but in either case, it has to involve the interaction of others. So it's all about how you actually lead and whether you lead from the front or the middle or behind or wherever. There are lots of leadership styles, from the overtly personal, the sort of the me style, which it could be called transformational leadership style. But for my money, instilling a collective sense of purpose and creating a leading organisation is infinitely more preferable. That's how we ran Saatchi's in New Zealand, and it certainly worked for us. Rather than one or two stars, we were more like an onion. You could keep peeling the layers away and still find the same quality. And we went out of our way, and I really believe this, in making the company the star as opposed to the people. It's a much more robust, much longer-term way to handle leadership. Saatchi's was better known in New Zealand than in its home country, the UK. Which is remarkable, actually. We even had a little book of rules called A Bit of a Tip. It was a guide to how to behave and act, so the Saatchi experience was seamless. And we wrote this little book because it always occurred to me that, you know, you'd always sort of live in fear of what was someone saying on our behalf. You know, what was someone who was rocking out to a meeting saying, you know, we at Saatchi's believe, ... And you think, I wonder what they're saying we believe. So we did sort of codify it, and we called it, you know, just a bit of a tip, here's what we believe. So leadership for me is much more about an organisational leadership than it is personal leadership in terms of running organisations. And a good example of this was this slide that we couldn't take a photograph because the photograph doesn't exist. But Saatchi's most revered leader was Charles Saatchi. And he was so shy in retiring that, true story, when he found himself unexpectedly in a room full of clients, he seized a broom from the cupboard and made his exit, sweeping away disguised as a cleaner. It's an extraordinary thing. So here's this guy, you know, Saatchi and Saatchi. And he was a truly charismatic leader, except that he was invisible. because everything was done not through the power of one individual, but through the power of the organisation that he created. And I just think it's a really good lesson for us. So, you know, we were rocking away and I was learning that whole minutage thing and, you know, looking for similarities, not differences and so on. And then, of course, 9/11 happened. I was stuck in Paris at the time and my wife and daughter stuck in downtown New York. They were looking out the window as the thing was happening. And it was soon after that that we decided to come home to New Zealand and to come home to then absolutely nothing. There was nothing really other than a no-compete clause in my contract. That was it from there. So I had no idea what I'd do because, you know, you get so used to being in a bigger organisation and being sort of carried along and, you know, you don't know how things sort of magically happen, but coffee is there when you want it and the computer works and just stuff happens. And then you suddenly come back here and nothing happens. It's a really humbling time. You know, it's an amazingly humbling time. So, you know, I had no idea what I'd do or how I'd keep the family in the manner, as they say, to which they had become accustomed, and me too, for that matter. So it was a question of what to do. One of my roles as Chief Operating Officer had been to convene and chair a worldwide planning board, and planners and agencies are our strategists. And between us, we had spent years sort of looking at ways to reinvent the advertising model from the inside out, and to become, you know, what we all claim to be an ideas company. But the reality was that, as the Irish would say, you can't get there from here. In the end, we concluded that you have to start from a clean slate. It's impossible to do what we wanted to do because it's such a legacy business. And, you know, you might want to change the way you do everything, but your clients don't necessarily want to follow suit, and they happen to pay the bills, and so they have contracts, and so you can never sort of break free of the legacy. So we thought, when I came back to New Zealand, that we'd apply the royal we, there's only me at the time, all those lessons and start from scratch. So back in New Zealand, Kim Thorpe, who I mentioned before, who was now the chairman of Saatchi's in New Zealand, suggested we join forces in a I will if you will basis. And so we began a company called Assignment. And our basic proposition was that senior clients could work directly with us, lucky things, to get to the right answers to problems and opportunities that they and their traditional advisors could not. Because the thing about agencies or big companies is the only time that clients will ever meet with the senior people is when you're winning the business and getting it on board. And then, you know, as I've learned in the advice business, you know, then you just sort of pass the thing on. So you pass that issue down the ranks, and that's how you monetize everything. But actually, the best thinking in most organizations, again, is at the top or right at the bottom. It's the middle bit's the bit that's useless. You know, it's the bit that really costs money and creates drag and is just, you know, you don't want to be stuck there. So we thought, really clever, we'll just be the top bit. So what we'll do is we'll assemble a brilliant agency that won't be an agency because it won't have any of the middle or the bottom. There'll just be a group of people. So we were quite impressed by this thought. We thought we would charge only fees for our services. There'd be no margins or commissions, all the things that normally advertising agencies do. We'd work only with senior management, and we would approach every problem with a completely open mind. So rather than replicating solutions, we would start everything with a fresh sheet of paper. We wouldn't enter awards and we wouldn't talk to the press. So in combination in the communications business, this we thought was a killer app. As advertising people, naturally, we used advertising to launch our new enterprise. And the ad read, it's a big ad, lots of type. The ad read, we don't want any staff and we don't want any clients. Now, how can we help? You'll be pleased to know the ad worked really, really well. We didn't get any clients. it was a frightening moment. This is true. We had no idea what was going to happen. So we ran the ad, and at that time it was my old PA from New Zealand end, Shona Walling, Kim Thorpe and I, and we sat in our office and waited for the phone to ring because we thought, shit, this will, you know, it'll be amazing. And then nothing happened until about 11 o'clock. And then I think we got a call from someone in Christchurch who was setting up a dry cleaning business or something. And so it was a frightening time because, you know, everything we thought we knew, we suddenly thought maybe we don't know what we know. It was a really interesting time for us. So the market didn't take it seriously because they didn't believe that we were serious. You know, they thought, oh, yeah, this is really interesting. This is just sort of, you know, this is very dilettante-ish. And these guys can't be serious about getting their hands dirty. They couldn't understand what we did. And in all honesty, we struggled to explain our vision. Nowadays, it sort of rolls off the tongue. And it's, you know, we apply creative judgment to business. Senior business leaders get it and are happy to pay for it. But not in the beginning. In many ways, our view was too much of an insider's view of what was wrong with advertising, but for most, it was far too subtle, and they just didn't get it. James Hall and Howard Grieve did, however, so much so that H, as we call him, offered to leave his role as creative director in Wellington to join us for nothing. So that was his offer to join us. I'll do it for free. James resigned from his UK chairman's role, and so assignment group then, because there were our you know, we'd doubled in size overnight, was born. We decided that we would be a true partnership, equal shareholding, equal pay, equal everything. It's a really interesting way to run a business, you know, because there are just no issues about fairness, because it's, you know, all for one, one for all. And I'll explain that in a second, but I remember one of the worst days, if not the single worst day in my career, was soon after we had gathered as a team for the first time, so there were the four of us now. And remember, each of the partners had given up quite a lot to pursue this somewhat ill-defined dream. But we did so because we had and have always shared the belief, or should I say idea, certainly not necessarily a fact, I've come to the conclusion, that if you gather the best people around you, everything else will fall into place. And I think that's just an absolute truth. You know, no matter what business you're in, if you can corner the best people in that business and you can hang on long enough, you will absolutely, you know, carve out a real place in that business. So we thought, you know, four really good people, we really work well together, we've got great complementary strengths, all those good things, this is a no-brainer. Our finance advisor disagreed, and one sickening afternoon, he set out to demonstrate how unworkable our business model was and how doomed to failure we were. It was just awful, you know, just at the one time you want your finance guys to say, oh, brilliant, I think you're on a roll here. It was like, this will never work. Undaunted. We carried on, and the rest is sort of unwritten history. These days, we're a well-established, busy, and highly profitable business. We do have a really good time, and I just think, you know, I just think that's such an important, you know, we only, as far as we know, live once, and you've got to make it enjoyable. So we have a great time. We only work with people we want to work with, so we're really selective about who we work with. And we produce work that we're genuinely proud of. You know, it's just that whole sense of when you're doing something that you love doing and you do it well, it's a very good position to be in. Most of what we do now is in the form of recommendations. And our value is in that little phrase, assignment recommends. Sometimes there's advertising involved, but usually there isn't. And the thing about assignment recommends is what we find with senior clients is when they've had all the analysis and they've had all the facts and they've had all the consultants and they still need help making a call. You know, it's like, here's everything we know. And it's not as though they don't know everything that needs to be known. It's like, what do we do now? You know, what is the final call we're going to make? And that's where our sort of skills, I think, are really useful because we can, A, be really objective. And this naive intelligence thing, by the way, is an extraordinary tool. And you only have naive intelligence with a business for a very short period of time, and then you just know too much. You know, that we don't do that because that, you know, something, 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 or we can't do that because something's up. But when you come in absolutely fresh and you apply judgment, you can arrive at things in a fraction of the time that it would normally take. I'm just going to play two spots now because it is time for a commercial break. Just to give you, you know, as I say, we do very little sort of traditional advertising, but here are a couple of spots. One's for Hyundai, which we used to have Toyota at Saatchi's, and Hyundai is the new, as we would say, is the new Toyota. And then another one is for really a major piece of our client base, which is we handle tourism New Zealand around the world, and it's all handled out of our office in Auckland around the world. And I'll show you a spot which chances are you haven't seen. So we'll just play those. So that's how we worked as a consultancy, and I think I love the shot. We are absolutely at polar opposites of the consultancy model that we've been studying only this weekend past. It's not a case of who's right or wrong, but in our experience, what senior clients want more than anything is good judgment. So on the basis of what we've built, we've been bought up by a major holding company who have seen our model as the future of the industry. Our earn-out gives us, hopefully, good financial security. Which leads me on to some of the other companies we've created, and I'm going to rocket through this. When we were getting assignment up and running, we were coming to the conclusion that the value of ideas, like so many things, is in the doing. Whoopsie daisy, we could unplug that now, thanks. Is in the doing. We established a company with a partner from Saatchi's New York to develop a web-based tool, and our first client for that was Procter & Gamble, and our second was Walmart. Another one was a company called Engage, which we're running out of time to talk to you about this morning, but a fascinating thing with a professor from UCLA and Harvard called Karen Stevenson, who is all about the power of hidden networks within organizations. And if you can identify the hidden networks as opposed to the hierarchical networks, then you can actually unleash the power of organizations. Fascinating. The only thing that didn't work is trust. And these are all based on trust networks. And the thing about New Zealand is we do a lot of things on trust. We just trust that we can do it and we get on with it. We couldn't with Karen, unfortunately. And so there you go. The next one is Antipodes, and so on to Antipodes, a great little company where everything we've learned has been put to the test and every dollar we've earned has been put at risk. You know, it's just a classic thing. You should know when to leave well enough alone, but no, we've got to keep on going. Simon Woolley was a friend of ours in New York at the same time as I was there, decided to come back to New Zealand at about the same time that we were coming back. Simon had a great career in the restaurant business, but didn't want to get back into it as a restaurateur. And Simon had an idea for bottled water. Not a very well-formed idea, I hasten to add, and not one that we gave much attention to. In fact, in the very first sort of planning session that we had, another idea, which was canned wild tuna, got considerably more airtime. Nevertheless, the assignment team, James Hall, was still in the UK at that time, and Simon discussed the idea. And the question was, why are New Zealand restaurants putting bottled imported water from the other side of the world on restaurant tables when New Zealand is one of the best sources of pure products in the world? And so Antipodes was born. It wasn't called Antipodes then, and we didn't have any water and we had no bottles. We really had nothing but the faith in a good idea. But a great quote from Jeff Ross, which is, you know, you've just got to start. You know, the key thing is, and especially with new businesses, you know, you've just got to get going. So it's a good statement because only when you begin to put ideas into action do they actually have any value. That applies whether you choose to do business anywhere in the world. So here's the sort of sequence of events of starting a new bottled water company. We decided to give it a go. We agreed on a shareholding split, which was 30% for Simon, who was the one who was going to do all the work, 20% each for Kim Thorpe, Howard Grieve and I, and then 5% for Len Cheeseman, who was the graphic designer, and 5% for Neville Goldie, the same financial advisor who on another business said, you know, it's never going to work. Why we rewarded him, you know, twice, I don't know. We did it all on a handshake. We started with a bottle design. Simon and I visited there are major bottle importers in New Zealand, and we gathered up 50-odd bottle shapes that we could import and put them on a table. The rest of the team arrived, and in our first meeting, literally they wandered in and unerringly reached for the single most expensive and the least suited bottle out of the lot. You know, just it was more expensive by the power of, you know, three or four. And in the bottled water business, that sort of shape is not a good shape for holding carbonated water. So the unit cost of the bottle that they picked, which was a German medicine bottle, the unit cost of that bottle to us was more than anyone was currently paying for bottled water in New Zealand. So we thought, oh, here we go. We were the first, or would be the first, water to be sold in glass. And of course now there are literally dozens of competitors. You know, it doesn't take long for fermentation to kick in. The next thing we had to do was find someone to bottle the water for us, and as luck would have it, a small bottler in the Bay of Plenty was happy to do our bottling. So we ordered our first container of bottles. We settled on a name, which is Antipodes, obviously, and the design, the label. Then we got down to a couple of key issues. Who would we sell to and at what price? We decided to limit distribution to the restaurant trade. We felt we could demand and protect better margins in this way, as well as give restaurants a unique product with a healthy margin. We agree that the price should be set marginally higher than the major competitor, San Pellegrino, and be sufficient to at least cover some of our costs. So a local water that was more expensive than a famous one all the way from Italy was quite a big call. But, you know, there you go. It was a big call. But we made it. Well, we almost didn't, actually, because the very first sale was to Prego, you know, that fine restaurant in Ponsonby. Krishna Bodica had been the maitre d' at Simon Woolley's restaurant Metropole, and she was now one of the managers at Prego. So Simon, who had never sold anything to anyone, Krishna wasn't intending to buy an unknown expensive New Zealand water for her Italian restaurant. And she was really nervous about how she was going to let Simon down gently. But, you know, lovely idea, Simon, but we can't do it. But as luck would have it, Simon opened his sales pitch with the hell, Krish, I've never been so nervous in my life. I've never had to sell anything to anyone. And it's a true story. Krishna was so kind that she couldn't say no to Simon. And that was our very first order. And from there on in, it just started to gain momentum. We got to a stage where we had to make a call. If we kept importing empty, expensive German medicine bottles for our water, we'd go broke. So we made the call to have our own bottles made right here, which was terrific. True marketers that we are, we had the bottle designed to have the Antipodes Water Company embossed on the bottom of the glass. And then we placed the minimum order of 1 million bottles. And we sort of realised that we'd reached a point of no return, because we thought, you know, the decision was quite significant, because if it didn't work, who would want 1 million empty bottles? Fortunately, we were able to find another ball that had been identified as having water from an almost identical mineral composition to the existing supply. And it goes on forever, this, but the quality of the water is staggeringly important in the sort of high-end bottled water business. We found it by literally knocking on farmers' doors. We knew that the bore was somewhere in that sort of this broad region. We found it was on a kiwi fruit orchard, so we bought the farm, and we set about to build a world standard water plant. It was opened a little over a year ago by the Minister of Conservation. Nowadays, our exports exceed local sales. We're in dozens of countries, and we're in some of the top restaurants in the world, including Il Bulli in Spain, which is considered the world's best restaurant. So that was, you know, really quite reassuring. Are we out of the woods yet? Hell no. We've invested a fortune, at a terrible time to invest money, obviously. Let's do it, you know, let's build a factory just as the market plummets. We have a bank that's less excited about the future than we are. And as I say, the recession hit the morning after we opened the plant. Restaurants around the world are suffering as consumers curtail expenditure on luxury items. Our sales are static, and our growth actually is coming from new markets. So our thing is, there are a whole lot of high-end restaurants around the world. So the way through for us is just keep expanding. But new markets are expensive, so we just keep investing and keep investing and keep investing. But we absolutely believe in the power of that idea. So it's not without its challenges, but then again, nor should it be. So I'm going to wrap up now, and I'm just going to... I changed these last night, actually. I'm a great believer in long lists, you know, like hundreds of ideas, because there are hundreds of things that are important in any business. I don't think there are just one or two organising principles. But here are the ones that I thought could just be useful, and they've hopefully come out of what I've told you this morning. The first thing is that when you are doing business, you've just got to eliminate waste, root out negativity, and squash cynicism. You know, you can't run a successful business with a group of cynics. So if you've got a cynic in your management team, you know, the best thing you can do is fire them. You know, you have absolutely no obligation to carry them. You've got to root out negativity. I think, I didn't mention it there, but there's this whole thing of realistic optimism, which I think is a wonderful sort of principle to work by. You know, you have to be basically an optimist to be successful. You can't, you know, there isn't such a thing as a successful pessimist. So you've just got to sort of balance optimism, though, with a healthy dash of reality. But if you can get that right, you're in good shape. Absolutely keep an open mind. You know, good ideas can come from anywhere. And one of the people that I used to work with had this idea that you just keep the windows open and ideas, you know, you let the ideas in. And, you know, that's what serendipity is about, isn't it? Sometimes you'll have an idea and then all of a sudden it's in the sort of zeitgeist. It's everywhere. You know, it's just one of those things. And that's how these things happen. Building momentum is really important in a business. And that's why I think I got such a shock on Saturday with Daniel's approach to business analysis. And I'm sure it's right, but it is a very slow process. And the thing that you know, all my experience tells me that you can't put the brakes on things. You know, it's all about constant acceleration. You've got to just keep driving businesses faster and faster. Radical change, constant improvement. So make a big call, then get it right. Just keep on getting it better and better and better and better and better. And when you can't improve it anymore, break it all up and start again. And if you do that, you'll always be ahead of the game because everyone else will be imitating you if you're the market leader. So you are always in the best position to redefine what the market should be like. Make every minute count. You know, like make every minute count. And it's just so easy in business and in life not to do that and to see opportunity after opportunity slip by. You've absolutely got to trust your judgment if it's good. You know, if you can't trust your judgment, at least don't try to lead anyone else, you know, where you're going. So really be careful about that. Stay really nimble. And, you know, in New Zealand, that is a huge advantage that we have. We can be really nimble and you can run circles around multinationals just because you can make much smarter decisions. And the other thing about a market like New Zealand, if that's the market you've grown up in, is you actually do see the effect of your decisions. You know, in the US, we spend so much on research because you never really know. You know, it's such big markets. It's very hard, really, to judge how impactful your decisions are. Here, it's really glaringly obvious. You feel it the next morning. A quote that I live by, really, which is to sort of accentuate the positive and then just eliminate the negative. You know, just concentrate on what's good and get rid of the stuff that's not. And you've got to do both. You know, you've got to focus on both, and you can absolutely do that. And I think just finally, you've always got to work harder than you expect from anyone else. And that takes me, I don't have a watch on, but I think it's quite late now. And it takes me to the conclusion. So it's just left to say thank you very much for your time.
How many takes did it get for the dog to say bugger?
Oh, that's right. Training the dog to do that was extraordinary. But I think I was going to say on that Hyundai commercial, you know, where the little boy runs down the corridor and he's got, you know, the keys in his finger. How grieve, as Guy mentioned too, you know, he had to act that out. So, you know, here you have this 50-year-old sort of running along the border. And that's the fun thing about all, you know, that side of our business is what keeps you sort of young and active and, you know, bright and everything else. It's a fun thing. But that dog's passed on now, unfortunately, as they all do. Hiya.
Hi. When you're analysing a complex problem for a client, do you tend to have one of your management team focus specifically in it and drill into it, or do you actually at a senior level share and bounce things off and sort of do it together?
We have a there's no formula to actually what happens when we begin the process, but we have a set way of beginning, which is it's a high wire act, really. We start every new engagement, we begin with what we call an away day. And in our experience, one of the things, and what happens on away day, back to Daniel at Hotel Devant, which has gone bankrupt, I see, is we have, you know, there are no phones, there are no emails, there are no other meetings. The senior management team are locked in the room. And one of the huge benefits of that is it's amazing what you can do when you actually put time to it. And so often senior management believes that life is in sort of half-hour increments, and beyond that, you know, how could they possibly have that time to devote to a particular issue? So we say you've got to devote the time, and that we won't leave this room until we as a team have come up with some sense of the way forward. And then we also say that we will approach the issue without any prior concept of what we think the right direction might be or what tools we might be to get to the right answer. And we always begin, the skill really is that the senior people in the room sort of know the answers. Deep down, somewhere in there, the answer, you know, that it's their business. But they have trouble articulating it or following a thread, or and we just, that's what we do. It's a high wire act because it's, we never go through a standard set of tools or a standard approach. We just work with them until we, it's like, I always explain, it's a bit like in fishing. If you get a knot, to undo a knot, you just start picking at the knot, and you just start, you start in a lot of places, and it's not until you suddenly find a loose thread and you follow that thread and that leads to something else, and in the end everything, you know, unravels. It's a really interesting way to work, and it's the complete opposite of a sort of a linear solution. But we think at that most senior level, you know, it's never a linear solution. It's never, we've done this, therefore we should do that. It's like, we could do that, but on the other hand, it's So I don't know if that explains it, but it's an interesting way of doing it.
You talk a lot about creative judgment on the one side, but the part that I hear on this other side, you have an increasing power of the right of data. Whether we're talking about the power of the supermarket using data,
yep.
An increasing organization like Google using algorithms to make its judgments. So data-driven judgments.
Yep.
How do you reconcile all those two?
We use data a lot, but what we do with data, Richard, is we don't do the data gathering and analysis. That's always brought to the table, and by the time we get involved, that's been done, but the outcome, the application of those findings is the thing that causes the problem. It's not that you don't know what the facts are or what they're telling you, it's just, what do we do with it? How do we apply that? So I think data is grist to the mill, and the more the merrier. But the problem is being able to rise above that to start making calls on its, on actually what it's telling you, and that's the thing that senior management have the most trouble with. So I think we're really sort of comfortable in the world of applied data. We're not comfortable, we don't even attempt to gather the data. There's always someone to do that. It's the what it's telling you and what it's probably not telling you. And often ideas are in the lines between the data lines, you know, they're in the, and it's seeing it with a fresh set of eyes and bringing judgment calls that's where we think we add value. That's certainly what we charge for. The other thing, by the way, about charging is if you charge enough, you absolutely get people's attention. And that's so often what happens. You know, you don't charge enough, so it's not given the attention it deserves. If you charge enough, then everyone's eyes are really focused because it's, ooh, hell. we're going to pay serious attention to this. So I just think, you know, the only risk with data for me is that it can absolutely just paralyze decision making. So the whole trick is to rise above it.
You talk a lot about judgment, and I think that's good, but you said it can be learned. But I wonder, can judgment be taught? And if somebody doesn't have judgment, where do you go to get it?
Well, I reckon it can absolutely be taught, because I think I learned it from watching it in action. And I've seen people with fantastic judgment and people with poor judgment, and I think that we're all capable of distinguishing between the two, and the more we're able to distinguish between the two, the faster we learn it. So I think if it can be taught by example, it must be able to be taught. Absolutely.